This is my fourth episode of the Angelique Everett Show, and I am your host, Angelique. I've got an opportunity to sit with my newest friend and special guest, Miss Hannah Ginn. She is an advocate for people with developmental and intellectual disabilities, advocate such as sexuality rights, and rights to have romantic relationships. She used to teach sexual health classes for adults with intellectual and developmental disabilities. Now, she is a graduate student at the UB of Social Work. She learns about ways that staff can support people's relationships so that everyone can have the kinds of relationships they want. She takes what she learns to advocate for people's rights. Thank you, Hannah.
Thank you, Angelique.
I heard you are the famous Hannah Ginn that Sophia been telling me about. So, tell me about yourself.
Sure. So, you know, first off, I want to say thank you so much, Angelique, for having me on your podcast. I really admire your work and really appreciate the chance to talk on your show. And a big shout out to Sophia Roberts, too, for connecting us. So, as you said, right now I'm a doctoral student at the University at Buffalo School of Social Work. And as a social work researcher, my work is about making sure people with intellectual and developmental disabilities have rights to sexual and romantic relationships. So this means having the right to meet and spend time with partners, the right to have information and support with relationships, the right to have alone time and privacy with partners. So I look at how staff, guardians, and then the rules at agencies sometimes don't respect people's rights to have these kinds of relationships. And then I learn how to fix this and advocate to make sure people's sexual rights to have relationships are protected.
That sounds very interesting. Okay. So tell me a little bit about your background.
Yeah. So when I lived in the state of Wyoming, I used to teach sexual health classes, as you were saying, for adults with intellectual and developmental disabilities. And people, you know, really enjoyed getting to talk about relationships and sexuality and found it really useful. And a lot of times people didn't get to talk about those topics, so it was really an important way for people to learn and share experiences. But I noticed that a lot of people with intellectual and developmental disabilities were not having their rights supported. So, for example, you know, some guardians and staff said somebody couldn't have private time, you know, with their boyfriend or their girlfriend, or sometimes they stopped them from being physically intimate with their partner. So this meant their right wasn't being supported, and I felt like we needed to do something about it.
Okay. It sounds very interesting. Okay. How did you become an advocate? How do you become an advocate for people with intellectual and developmental disabilities?
So, you know, I saw a lot of ways that, you know, people were wanting to have relationships, but this wasn't always being supported. And there was a lot of confusion about, you know, what the rules were and what was the best way to support people. And so, you know, I thought that all of the ways that people's relationships weren't being supported wasn't fair or okay, and that we had to, you know, do something to make sure everybody's rights were being protected. So I've now come to the University at Buffalo to learn, you know, why people's rights aren't being supported, and then to learn about ways that we can make sure that they are.
Sometimes people with disabilities do not have their rights for romantic relationships supported. Could you tell me about some of the ways this happens?
Yeah, definitely. So, you know, there are a lot of different ways that this can happen. Many staff are really doing an awesome job, you know, supporting people, but sometimes they aren't sure what the rules are when it comes to supporting people's relationships and sexuality. So they might not support somebody because they're afraid of getting in trouble with their agency or a person's guardian. And a lot of people with intellectual and developmental disabilities talk about feeling lonely because they don't have enough ways to meet people and spend time with people they care about. You know, another thing that happens is sometimes staff and guardians are afraid that if somebody has a boyfriend or a girlfriend or is alone with them, they might get hurt or experience abuse. So some guardians and staff try to say, you know, what somebody is allowed or not allowed to do with a partner. Mm-hmm. But, you know, relationships always have some kind of risk, and to stop somebody from having a relationship because something bad could happen breaks their rights to relationships.
I agree about that.
Yeah, and I think, you know, the very like last thing would be like, we have these assessments called capacity to consent that agencies do.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
That's a good thing, so they know. So they basically know what they're agreeing to.
Right. Yeah. Consent. Right. And so, you know, these assessments ask a lot of questions about relationships, and they're kind of like a test almost. And staff then use these assessments to decide if somebody is allowed to have a sexual relationship. And the assessments are supposed to protect people, but in a lot of ways they're not fair, and they can be used to stop people from having rights. So I think we need to find a way to make sure that they protect people's rights instead of take their rights away. So those are just a couple different ways.
Yeah, that's good. Now I'm going to get, this might not be off topic, but I know it's kind of the same thing, but how did you become a strong advocate for the LGBTQ community?
Yeah, I think a lot of times, you know, when we talk about relationship rights, you know, some people think only about a relationship between a man and a woman. But that it's super important, you know, to also make sure that when we're talking about rights, we're talking about relationships between any people wanting and agreeing to be in a relationship, like you were saying, with consent. And so, you know, this could be a relationship between a woman and a woman, or between two men, or between somebody who doesn't feel like either a man or a woman and another person. And people, I think, you know, really want to be able to talk to staff about the types of people that they want to be with and the ways that they feel about themselves. And I think that we need to make sure that staff are prepared to talk to people if this is something that's important to a person, so that we can make sure that people feel really supported about themselves and, you know, who they want to be with.
I agree about that, because I actually have a couple of friends and a couple of people that I used to work with that choose to be, you know, chooses to be with a man or a woman, you know, so I really do support that. And when they had told me, I'm like, oh, okay, well, I love you anyways. And I used to, you know, like I said, I used to work with staff and stuff like that, you know, that used to be that way. I know there was one staff that I didn't know, it was just on the topic in the subject of relationship. And she basically asked me, was I in a relationship, you know? I'm like, yeah, I am. And then I told her the dude's name and everything, you know, and she basically told me, see, well, I'm in a relationship as well, too, with a partner. I'm like, oh, okay. And that's when she had told me that, you know, it wasn't a man, it was a woman. I'm like, oh, well, that's all right. I can't wait to meet this partner.
Yeah.
So I got really to meet her partner. And not to be really nice and sweet.
Oh, cool.
And I loved her too, so.
Totally, totally. So it sounds like you're an advocate as well.
Yes, I guess I am. But I didn't want to apply sexuality. I never, you know, because I am a playwright, you know, and I just thought about it. And I'm like, well, that would be a good topic to talk about, play-wise, you know, and see what people think about the play, you know. You know, there are a lot of people that be judging people on their sexuality.
Mm.
So I will write a play about it and to, you know, show them, and just, you know, show them that it's not right to judge people on how the way they look or on their sexuality.
Yeah, yeah, I love that idea. And so kind of like how you wrote a children's book, then you'd be writing a play. That's really cool.
Well, I'm also thinking about tapping into, because, you know, I actually wrote a second book, you know, a sequel to the first one. And I was thinking about, we were talking about it, because I have a friend, which I'm going to do a shout out to her right now, Bev Geyer. And she is awesome. She actually not just helped me write the play, but she also directed the play as well, too.
Well, oh, great.
Yeah, but,
kind of a collaboration.
Back then it was Up Productions, but now it's Unique Theater Company now. And I'm telling you, she's really awesome. She actually helped me direct the play and everything. I was actually in the audition. She had me in the audition process as well. I got to really see the actors and everything that got to audition for my play and everything. So I had the experience, I would say, per se, in the process of performing my play. So I And then not just one, but two plays that were performed, and I'm telling you, them nights, you couldn't even buy tickets anymore because they were all sold out.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, I wish I could have seen it.
Well, you probably still could, because I know the one is actually, I think, still on YouTube, I think.
Oh, cool. Okay.
The first one was called Respect. That is actually based on a serious topic, you know, nonfiction topic. The second one was based on this fiction. So I thought, you know, when I was thinking about it, I was like, well, it would kind of be nice to kind of write another play, a dirt play, but this time based on a nonfiction topic like I did in the first play.
Yeah, interesting.
So, I was thinking about sexuality at first. I'm like, well, that is actually a nonfiction topic, and it's a topic that kind of needs to be heard. You know, people need to know about it. So I think, why not? I think a lot of play about it. My first time writing a play like that, really, in a way, kind of in a play like that. So.
Oh, very cool. Yeah, mm-hmm. Definitely look forward to seeing that.
Oh, what do you think are some good ways to make sure people's rights and choices about relationships are supported?
Yeah, this is a really good question. I really like thinking about the ways that we can support people's rights and not just all of the barriers. And so I think the biggest thing that I see is that we need to change those assessments I was talking about, the capacity to consent assessments. You know, I think that we should use assessments to find ways to support rights instead of stopping people from having rights. So this would mean making changes to the rules in New York State or even the whole United States. And I think if we could make those big, you know, rules changes, then agencies can help staff. So then staff can know what to do. And then they can give staff training. So I really think agencies also, you know, deserve and need money and resources to support people's relationships. So we need the government to give agencies more money to hire and train staff and to provide transportation so people can visit each other. So basically, I think, you know, we need some big rules changes and then more support from the government to make it happen. And I thought it would be really cool too if that, you know, this movement would also be led by people with intellectual and developmental disabilities. So it could really be powerful to create a group of people who wanted these changes to protect rights and to come together to talk to the government about it. So that's just one idea I have. But yeah, I think the big rules changes, basically.
I agree about that. But the one group that I will actually just draw out there and make a shout out to, which would be self-advocacy in action. I'm actually a big part of self-advocacy in action. I'm actually involved with that. I'm actually one of the hosts of their TV show, including their podcast. And I know that group would be awesome to help you with that as well. We are always up to new projects and stuff like that too. So
that would be fantastic. Yeah, if people are interested, I definitely think it's some rights that we need to be fighting for. So that's exciting.
There are a couple of people that you can kind of reach out to, which would be, and I'm going to make a shout out to, which is Sophia Roberts. Me and you both love her.
Right.
There is James Jowsey, which is actually my life coach, and he's my life coach. I love him. You haven't met him yet, but you will love him once you meet him, though. There is Mike Rogers as well too, and. Him and Sophia actually work together. Those three will kind of help you kind of work through that and everything. I actually work really hands-on with Jim, but I also work hands-on with Sophia as well, too.
Wow, yeah. Sounds like a great team.
They're really awesome. And then I have my friend Alex Jesko. He actually is like the editing and everything, you know, so the editor and everything. So I put, like I said, I had to make a shout out to my group, Self-Advocacy in Action, because that group can really help you a lot and everything with that as well, too. So sounds
like a powerful, yeah, collaboration and group of people.
So I just had to throw that out there and put that out there. Make like a little shout out to them, you know. So we love to do fun different projects and everything. So
yeah, that would be a great collaboration.
Yeah, it would. And we could probably help you out with the government and stuff like that too, you know. So
that would be amazing. Yeah.
How do you learn how people's rights to relationships are supported?
Yeah. So for me, I read a lot of things that people with intellectual and developmental disabilities say, or things that they communicate about relationships. And, you know, people talk about the kinds of things that get in the way to having relationships, and they talk about the ways that they want to be supported. And you know, I also read things that staff and guardians say about relationships, and I talk to providers and staff to hear about things that they see getting in the way and their ideas to protect rights. So I think that research really helps us bring together all of these different voices to find a way forward. So it's kind of a way to get a lot of different perspectives together at the table.
Oh, okay. Why are you a strong advocate for Black Lives Matter movement?
Yeah, definitely. And we talked about this a little bit before, but the movement, you know, for Black Lives is just doing really important and amazing work to make sure that Black people and Black communities are safe and thrive. And this country really has a, you know, long history of being unjust to Black people and people with disabilities. And I think the Black Lives Matter movement and the disability rights movement are both so important to making sure that people can live the kinds of lives that they want free from danger. And I think that you know, and that people have what they need to grow, be happy, and make their own choices. And recently I've seen the movement for Black Lives talking about, you know, ways to protect the lives of Black people with disabilities too. And I think that that's so important, and that these movements have a lot to share with each other to create a world where everybody has their needs met and their well-being supported.
I agree, because I actually signed up on their email list. So I've been getting emails and stuff like that from them. Sometimes I actually follow them on Twitter as well too. So they actually send me stuff on Twitter as well. So, and I just figured to kind of be, I guess, an advocate, as you would say, as you would put it in that way, because since I am actually a woman and a woman, I'm doing today, I'm a woman of color, and I'm also a woman with a disability as well too. So I figured, you know, why not follow them, you know, why not be an advocate for that when I am actually a woman of color?
Yeah, definitely.
Oh, Well, I major in social work.
Yeah, I love social work. To me, you know, social work is a way to make my life about protecting and enabling people's rights. It gives us a way to see when people are being treated badly or unfairly, and gives us tools to make change so that we can stop injustice. It says that, you know, everybody is worthy of dignity and respect, and that we need to make a society that cares for all people and helps all people live the kinds of lives that they want. So yeah, that's really why I'm a big social work fan.
Okay. And why you want to be a social worker?
Yeah, I think, you know, getting to spend every day working on making a more just society and making sure that we've secured people's rights and are supporting people's rights is really the way that I want to live my life. So social work, yeah, really lets me be able to do that.
Yeah. That's good. I actually have someone that actually works in that is actually a social worker. So,
who is it that's a social worker?
Is that I actually have someone that I know that actually works as a social worker.
Oh, cool. Yeah. It's a good group of people.
Ooh, oh. Why do you go? Oh, this is the one right here. Why do you go on to social media?
Yeah. You know, I think social media can be a great tool for sharing ideas and information. You know, it can be a tool to get the word out about issues, to inspire people to care about, you know, different things, and for people to get involved in interested in making changes. So I think, yeah, it can be a great tool to connect people.
And I'm going to read you the quote that I was telling you about that kind of gave me the idea of asking that question.
Yeah.
As far as self-confidence goes, so much of social media is about approval, getting likes, comparing our lives to others. Meanwhile, confidence is an inside job. It's about how you feel about yourself, regardless of what anyone else does or thinks. It's a knowing that you're human, you're flawed, and you're awesome in your own way.
I love that.
I was reading that quote. You know, I'm not that positive, but you know, when I'm on Facebook, I always, you know, go to the quote page, and I say, well, I like this quote, so I would just put it up on my Facebook page. So as I was reading the quote, it was like under self-confidence. So I'm like, oh no, this is the perfect one. And I had came up with this light bulb idea, like I said, that popped up in my head, and I'm like, that would be a good topic to talk about for the Enjoy Show. Like I said, I kind of made it a trend on Facebook, and I asked people, like, why do you go into social media? And I was like, and I was started. So I kind of told them the reason why I go on to social media, which was basically, you know, I go on it for not just personal wise, but also go on it for business wise as well too. You know, since I am a children's book author, I have a Facebook page, an Olivia Facebook page. And I even have the Angelique Show page as well, too, on Facebook. And, you know, that's a good way to kind of market it out there and put it out there and let people know about the Angelique Show, you know, and why I wanted to start to do a TV show like that as well too. So that's why I go onto Facebook, you know. And then I do have a personal page, and I like to connect with people, you know, friends I haven't talked to in a while, you know, that I do think about. So I kind of made it like a hot topic and I guess a hot trend on Facebook by me asking that question to people and to see what their feedback are, you know. So I got two people that actually commented on that particular question on Facebook.
Yeah, that's great. And I think that, it's totally just a great tool to get the word out and, you know, share important ideas and let people engage and talk together in a way that, especially with the pandemic and kind of COVID keeping us all in our homes, it's a way we can all stay connected and keep conversations going.
Like I told Sophia, you know, even though we have social media and everything, it's all right. But, you know, some people, they use it for all the wrong reasons as well, too, in a way. In a negative way, I'm talking about. You know, like airing out your day laundry on there, like relationships and stuff like that. And, you know, that's kind of, you know, it's basically like online bullying, cyberbullying, you know. And cyberbullying is not good to do all the time, you know.
Right.
Have a tough skin, but still not nice to do.
Right. Social media, can be a good thing and a bad thing, but it matters how people use it, definitely.
Yeah. Yeah, some people can be mean as well, too, in a way.
Right.
I had some experience with that, so not bullying, but just, you know, people being mean and stuff like that, you know, so.
Yeah, I'm sorry you had to experience that.
But there's also a movie out there that's called Cyberbullying. It's called Cyberbully. So, I actually had seen it myself a couple of times.
Yeah, I haven't heard of it before.
It's called Cyberbully. And my favorite actress is in it, Emily Osment. And she was actually had started bullying somebody on social media, and then it kind of bit her in the behind a little bit by her starting it technically.
Yeah, I'll have to check that out. I haven't.
They have actually two different ones, because they also have one that's called Bully, and then another one is called Cyber Bully.
Oh, okay. Yeah, kind of two parts.
Yeah, but it's not the same movie though, because, you know, Bully and Cyberbully is kind of two different things in a way. Because Bully is really sad. I actually got to see the documentary. I went to UB and saw the documentary, and I was like literally in tears, because there were kids basically that committed suicide technically because of it. And that is sad to hear.
It is, yeah.
So people can even do that on, you know, do social media, you know, cyberbullying as well, too. They actually commit suicide because, and they be depressed, and they commit suicide because of it. Because of what somebody had said through social media.
Right. So it can definitely be a tool for good and a tool for bad, but yeah.
How the way you, you know. So that's the reason why I came up with the idea of just asking people, why do you go on to social media?
Yeah, get a conversation started, and that's great.
So I figured, you know, it'd be kind of nice to have like a panel discussion and to talk about it and see what people say, you know, get direction and stuff like that.
Yeah. It seems like a good topic for another podcast episode.
Well, this right here is not really a podcast. This is really a TV show right now.
Because we have the visual. Yeah, true.
But later on, it will be the podcast because my podcast is not really called the Angelique Show. It's actually called Chit Chat.
That's right, right.
But I'm not going to mention about it. I'm not going to mention about it that much because people don't know about it right now. I wanted to kind of surprise people.
Yeah, have kind of an unveiling.
So I'm just going to tell people right now. Y'all, forget what I just said about that. Because right now it's a surprise. Surprise! I am your host, Angelique Galbraith. And this has been another episode of the Angelique Everett Show. And thank you, Hannah, for coming out of your busy schedule for me to interview you. I'm Angelique, and I'm rocking it.
Thank you so much, Angelique.
You're welcome, Hannah.